cause to see my sins upon that cross.
Can we think about that for just a moment? We will never know, God, how much it cost the King of the universe. He chose to come down and robe himself in flesh. He chose to make a way for us to be able to have that relationship. He desired so much for you to be in his presence that he rent the veil. He made a way. It was outside of a religious system. It was outside of the ways of man. God wanted there to be a relationship with you. He chose to give himself for you. I will never know truly the cost of my Lord, but I am here today to worship.
Amen.
Fills this place. I come to praise and worship the Lord today. Amen. 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 I'm going to make a special request of Brother Junior, since he hadn't testified yet. I would like to hear him sing that song that he wrote in prison concerning, wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way by taking heed thereto according to thy word. He sings a lot better than I do. Sing it, Brother Junior. Say something for the Lord.
I just appreciate the presence of the Lord. I appreciate him so much in my life. You know, the Bible says that.
Why don't you be seated, everybody?
Where two or three are gathered together in his name, that he's in the midst of it. You know, and whenever God is in the midst of us, you know, the Bible says that God has all power in heaven and earth, and him, he has all, he's all powerful, and God can do exceeding abundantly above all that we could ever ask or think of. And you know, when God is really in the midst of us, the Bible tells us that whatever we ask on earth, you know, I mean, whatever we ask, we shall receive if we believe, you know, and whatsoever, when we come before him, and we have faith that God can do it. And I just appreciate it because, you know, I'm learning that, you know, it's through prayer, you know, when I come before God. And I'm just, he's really been showing me some things. I just thank him for being in my life. Anyways, I don't know about this song, Pastor. I want to sing it, but I'm going to be obedient because I need to find the right key first.
Everybody say hallelujah. I will not forget thy word. Amen. God bless you today. I trust that everybody has a little outline of what we're going to talk about this morning. Learning how to be steadfast. I like that word, steadfast. Faithful. Responsible. Mature. Sometimes we have to wade through a little confusion to be able to be steadfast. If you haven't had a season of confusion yet in your relationship with God, you will. Because God is so high and so far up there, His ways are higher than our ways. As high as the heavens are above the earth, His ways, His thoughts are higher than our ways and our thoughts. And that can be a serious problem sometimes. For example, there was a great man in the Bible by the name of Jeremiah. Jeremiah, the prophet of God. He wrote one of the longest books in the Bible. He prophesied at a time of things going down. He prophesied at a difficult time in Israel's history. He wasn't privileged to live when the nation was seeking God. He had the unenviable task of trying to preach to a bunch of backslid people, stiff-necked, idolatrous. He didn't get very many converts. He couldn't really focus on his work for God. He had to constantly focus on his walk with God. Because sometimes your work for God can really not be too pleasant to look at. Sometimes your work for God can be a little less than what others are having. But I got news for you. Your walk with God is a whole lot more important than your work for God. And somehow Jeremiah was preaching and saying, the Babylonians are coming, and it's futile to resist the Babylonians. And God has turned against the people of Israel because of a long history of breaking His covenant, and the final reckoning is here. That wasn't a very pleasant message. It wasn't very patriotic. It wasn't very encouraging. And yet, it was the word of the Lord. And Jeremiah prophesied that we're going to go into captivity. We're going to be subjected to another nation for 70 years. And then the Lord comes along and says, Jeremiah, your cousin's going to come, and he's going to want you to buy his property. So I want you to buy that parcel of ground. And sure enough, his cousin came along and said, I got some land over here in Anathoth where we're from, and I'd like to sell it. You need to redeem it, and I need the money. So Jeremiah gave him the money, and then Jeremiah got a little confused about all that because, you know, he didn't understand. Why is it, God, that you want me to buy property when our government is fixing to be overthrown? Have you changed your mind, God? I mean, God, this is just a little confusing to me. Because when the Babylonians come in, all the laws of the Jewish people are going to be suspended. Every bit of property is going to belong to the king of Babylon. And it looks like I'm chasing good money after bad. I'm confused, God. Why do you want me to do that? Why did you tell me to do that? Jeremiah didn't get a bad attitude. You ever question God? Sometimes I feel a bad attitude coming up. But I say, that ain't going to do no good. Come to God humbly. Jeremiah humbly said, "Ah, Lord God, behold," this is Jeremiah 32, 17 through 19. "Behold, thou hast made the heaven and the earth by thy great power and stretched out arm, and there's nothing too hard for thee. Thou showest loving kindness unto thousands and recompense the iniquity of the fathers unto the bosom of the children after them. The great, the mighty God, the Lord of hosts is his name. Great in counsel, mighty in work, for thine eyes are open upon all the ways of the souls of men." You get the picture, folks. Jeremiah was praising the Lord, and I don't have time to read the whole prayer, but after he began with a good spirit and a good attitude of praise, that's the way you inquire of the Lord, folks. Because I got news for you. God's got an answer for all your confusion. Now, my message today may not be real deep and it may not be a barn burner, but I'm not worried about that. I want to help that person that's out there sitting in this congregation that's going through a little time of confusion in your life. Hallelujah. That's normal. It's not abnormal to have a little time of confusion. But what's abnormal is for you to stay in that state of confusion. Now, you did the right thing by getting up and combing your hair and putting on perfume or cologne and coming to the house of God. Amen. Because God's got an answer for your confusion this morning. Isn't that neat? How the Lord knew what you needed before you got here. And he's already talking to you this morning. And he's trying to help you to understand that he's God, and there's none other. He heals, he kills, he makes alive, and no man can deliver out of his hand. And he has compassion on us because he knows he expects things of us that's hard for us to do. He looks at us and he has pity, and he realizes that, you know, he didn't sit down with Job and say, put his arm around Job and say, "Now, Job, you're fixing to have a pretty rough go here. But just hang in there. It'll have a good end." He didn't do that. Job had to walk by faith. It was a little confusing. Job went through a period of confusion. Are you confused this morning? I got a God that can unconfuse you. Now, the long and the short of this is God spoke to Jeremiah at the end of his prayer and said, "Jeremiah, I just want you to understand that it's only going to be 70 years. And then there's going to be buying and selling and purchasing of property just like it always has been. It's going to be a little hiatus from what you have had, but I just want you to understand that it's going to be all right." Hey, it's going to be all right. Ladies and gentlemen, everything's going to be all right. You may go through a time of difficulty, but I got news for you. It's going to be all right. Keep saying it. Everything's going to be all right. The devil's a liar. Things are not going to fall apart. I'm not going down. God's going to hold me up. God's got my number. God's got me in the palm of his hand. Glory to God. And the devil comes along huffing and puffing and saying he's going to blow your house down. Devil comes along and huffing and puffing and saying you can't make it. The devil comes along and lying to you, telling you all kind of goofy stuff. Don't listen to the devil. Get your nose in the word of God. Get your feet out here to the house of God. Get out here and listen to the songs and start worshiping God. Be steadfast in the Lord. It's one thing to get in church. It's one thing to get baptized. It's one thing to get the Holy Ghost. But it's quite another thing to just hang in there. Through the years, through the weeks, and through the months, and through the difficult times, and through all the murkiness of life, and through all the disappointments of life, you just keep landing on your feet and saying, "I still want to live for God. I ain't giving up on this heavenly home that is bright and fair. I feel like traveling on. Hallelujah. Amen. My heavenly home is bright and fair. I want to get a glimpse of it every once in a while because that's where I want to go. Amen. Amen. There was another man in the Bible. There were several people in the Bible, you know, that you're not the only one that's been down this road of confusion. Hello. Oh, and by the way, I asked the Lord, I said, whatever happened to that property? I said, there's something here I'm missing, Lord. We know that, you know, Jeremiah was, we read in the book of Nehemiah, you know, the reformers, after the captivity was over. We read in the book of Ezra. Did you know there was a Jeremiah over there listed in several places? And I've always thought that was another Jeremiah. But we don't know. Could it be that God kept Jeremiah alive those 70 years, and he come back from the captivity and he said, that land belongs to me because I purchased it 70 years ago? I don't know. I just throw that out for you to think about. God can keep you alive just like he kept Simeon alive to see the Messiah, just like he kept Caleb alive to see the land of Canaan and have his promise fulfilled. God makes promises to his children, but sometimes they don't happen the next day. God makes promises to his people, but it might take a little while for him to deliver on that promise. And in the meantime, it's your responsibility to be steadfast. I've often wondered about Simon Peter in the Bible, New Testament. You know, that guy that had the keys to the kingdom. Anytime an artist paints Peter in a famous painting, you know, he's always got a key in his hand. Because he's the guy that Jesus said, I'm going to give you the keys. Hey, that was pretty good, wasn't it? I got the keys, man. Not everybody's got a key to this building. Did you know that? If you ain't got a key, there's a reason why. If you got a key, there's a reason why. Amen, amen. But right after Jesus gave him the keys, Jesus said something Peter didn't like. It threw him into a spirit and attitude of confusion. Jesus said, fellas, I got some news to tell you. I'm going down to Jerusalem and they're going to spit on me. They're going to knock me around and slap me. They're going to bruise me. They're going to crucify me. No. No, no, no. We can't let that happen, Lord. I'm going to be there to. I'll take a bullet for you, Lord. You know, sometimes God tells us what's going to happen and we don't like it. We better be careful about trying to tell God what his plan ought to be. Now, let me tell you something. Peter would have saved himself a lot of time and trouble, a lot of worry and frustration, if he would have just said, okay, Lord, if that's what you say is going to happen, I receive it. I'm not going to fuss with you. I'm not going to argue with you. When they was in the Garden of Gethsemane and Judas come walking up with a mob of people to tie Jesus up and take him captive, if Peter would have just walked away and said, Lord, I'll see you later. You said this is going to happen. And it's happening. I'm just going to go home. No, that ain't what Peter did. What did he do? He tried to intervene. And Jesus said, put your sword up, Peter. You are messing up big time. But Peter, after Jesus told him to put his sword up, Peter followed afar off. And he got down there, and I don't know what was in his mind. He may have been trying to think, well, he's going to call 10 legions of angels. Maybe, I don't know what was in Peter's mind. Would have been better off if he would have just walked away and said, I've done everything I know to do. I don't understand. I'm in confusion. I can't change the situation. So I'm just going back to Capernaum. But no, he wound up denying Jesus. He wound up cussing. He wound up saying some horrible things. He wound up saying something that made him guilty. It made him feel bad, and Satan moved in on Peter and tried to destroy him. Jesus said, Satan has desired to have you that he may sift you as wheat. Boy, the devil can put some confusion on you. Did you know that? Oh, the devil can whisper in your ear and tell you lies. You ain't no good. You ain't never been any good. You're bad to the bone. You ain't nothing but a failure. On and on and on, the devil can talk. Oh, I want everybody to know the devil is a liar this morning. He's the father of lies. I ain't gonna listen to the devil this morning. I'm not listening to that voice that tells me I'm no good. I realize that I'm a failure. I realize that I am not good. But I also realize I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I realize that I don't have a lot of talent. I realize that I don't have a lot of ability. I realize that I'm lacking in a whole lot of areas. I realize I got flaws and failures, but I'm going to be steadfast. I'm going to hang in there. I'm going to believe that he's going to supply the strength, the power, and the mercy, and the grace to keep me going. You see, you're going to have to understand that God's got a big plan. He's the master architect. You know, sometimes a sheetrocker, a little lowly little guy that he's not the general contractor. He's a subcontractor. And the subcontractor does what the general contractor says. Because the general contractor has got a blueprint of the whole building. The general contractor knows where every electrical outlet's going to be. He knows where every wire is going to be. He knows where the plumbing is going to be under the cement. And the subcontractor comes in and says, I don't like this. Well, you just shut up. Well, I'm not supposed to say that. Yeah, I told y'all about where I grew up. My wife grew up, and she was taught never to say shut up. And our kids grew up, and my wife told them don't tell one another to shut up. But that was one of our favorite words in the neighborhood where I grew up. We just went around telling everybody, oh, just shut up. I just love to tell the devil to shut up. I give everybody permission in this church. I encourage you, just tell the devil to shut his mouth. You don't need to hear anything he's got to say. In fact, it'd be good for you to stay away from people that don't live for God. It'd be good for you to stay away from your unsaved relatives. It'd be good for you to swap your old relatives for your new relatives. You know who your new relatives are? You got some in Kansas City. You got some in Wichita. You got some in Denver, Colorado. You got some in Topeka, Kansas. It's all the people that have the baptism of the Holy Ghost, speaking with other tongues as the Spirit gives the utterance. It's good for you to have relatives. But your relatives can be your biggest enemy. Because you love your relatives. And the devil can speak through your relatives. And it's hard for you to tell your relatives to shut up. Your relatives will come to town on church night. And your relatives are going to look at you and say, "Well, I've just got a short time to be with you. You mean you're going to go to church on midweek Bible study?" And you know, it would be really smart for you to just stand flat-footed in your living room and just let your relatives that you ain't seen in 20 years I mean, you know, we can apologize and say, "Well, I'm sorry, my pastor, he'll be calling me tonight after church and wondering where I'm at. And, you know, I don't, my pastor expects me to be there, so I got to go." Or you can just look at him and say, "Hey, I'm so glad you came to see me." But just know, anytime it's midweek Bible study, I got to get down there to the house of God. I once was lost, but now I'm found. I don't want to backslide. I want to get some food for my soul. Hallelujah. I got to be in the house of God. And there's the refrigerator. You help yourself to the cabinets. You help yourself to the anything in this house. I'll be back probably about 9 or 9:30. But if you want to go with me, I'd love to have you. And you know what? If you look at them right in the eyes and they look at you and they realize that you're not wishy-washy about church. Oh, I'm trying to get you unconfused, okay? I hadn't left the subject. Somebody said, if the children ask the parents, "Are we going to church tonight?" You've done lost the battle. The kids ought to know, if it's church night, we're going to be in the house of God. Amen. That really went over good many years ago. It's not too good anymore, but that's the way I grew up. I had the idea I was supposed to be in church every time there was anything going on. If there was a hot dog feed, I thought I was supposed to be there. Plus, if we had church, I thought I had to be in the prayer room to pray before church every time, on Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, Friday night. Well, we had church all the time. We'd have church 7 days a week. I guess we have to. Anyway, I'm having a hard time getting used to this new way of doing things. This modern way. I'll go to church if I feel like it. I'll go to church and I'm not going to let anybody run my life. And you're going to get real confused. Because if you don't eat when the Lord is serving the meal, you're going to get weak spiritually. Do you not realize that every time there is a church service, there is some spiritual nourishment for you to nourish your spirit with? And if you miss that service, you're going to miss something God intended for you to get. And if you miss one service, do you not realize that that can be the difference between heaven and hell for you? Amen. Oh, glory to God. We can kind of be like Jonah. Poor Jonah. He wasn't like Jeremiah. He prophesied that Nineveh was going to be destroyed in 40 days. He wanted Nineveh to fry like Sodom and Gomorrah. He probably had that in his mind. Yet 40 days and Nineveh shall be destroyed. He enjoyed preaching that. You're going to fry, you Ninevite, you. You destroyed my country. You carried my people captive. You're going to die. The street here is going to be boiling like oil. These houses are going to be nothing but rubble. When the 40th day got there, he climbed up on a mountain outside of Nineveh. Ha! I want to see this spectacle. But it didn't happen. It didn't happen. Because those people was down there fasting and praying, asking God to not destroy their city. Even the cattle fasted. The dogs and the cats, the children had to fast. Well, you talk about desperate. Jonah was having the biggest revival of any Old Testament prophet ever had. He didn't have enough sense to appreciate it. And he gets mad at God. It displeased Jonah exceedingly. Jeremiah 4:1. It displeased Jonah. Is there someone here like that this morning? And he was very angry. It ain't going to get you anywhere to get angry with God. It's not going to do you one bit of good to be displeased with God. Give up on that idea. You're not on God's level. Amen. You just really just really ought to be glad that God don't make a greasy spot out of you. You just you ought to just be glad that God don't pick you up by the nape of your neck and drop you into the bottom of the pit. You ought to never ever think that you're ever near close anywhere near God's level. The Bible says that his ways are past finding out. You're going to try to find out what God's doing? He's not going to tell you everything he's doing. He just wants you to walk by faith. He wants you to praise him. Amen. He wants you to worship him. He wants you to glorify him because he's got a master plan. You ain't nothing but the subcontractor. He's the general contractor. He's got a big picture. He's got a big plan. And if Jesus had not have went to the cross and died, amen, and rose again, and there would have never been a day of Pentecost, we would be on a bar stool somewhere. We'd all be in hell if it wasn't for Jesus doing what God wanted him to do. Don't you appreciate the fact that Jesus looked at Peter and said, "Get thee behind me, Satan, for thou do not understand the things of God. You only think about the things of man. You only got a little snapshot of what I want to do. I've got the big plan. I've got the big picture." And when you finally see it, you're going to see and realize how ignorant you really are. Don't you know Peter, when he's saw what God did, he said, "Lord, I'm sure glad you didn't do what I wanted you to do. I'm sure glad you didn't go with my little stupid plan." And that's what you, that's exactly where you're at this morning.
Yeah, come on.
You kind of want to have a little attitude about God. "God, why didn't you let me get a parking place close to the door at Walmart or Costco or Sam's? God, why did you let me hit that pothole and knock the front of my car out of line? It's going to cost me money. God, why did you let me buy this lemon, this car I got? It ain't nothing but a lemon. It's always breaking down on me. God, why did you not let me get that pay raise that other guy got? Or God, why did you?" You fill in the blank. He's got a plan. He's working his plan in your life. You'd be real smart to just thank him for everything that's going on. You'd be real smart to say, Lord, I don't quite understand what's going on, but you know, I just want to thank you that you let this happen in my life and you let that happen, because I know nothing happens by accident. Everything has got a plan behind it, and you love me and everything's working out for my good because I love you, Lord, and I'm going to stick with you. I'm just going to stick with you. No matter what happens, I'm going to be steadfast. And so, if any of you lack wisdom, boy, is there anybody here that doesn't lack wisdom? I suppose that's kind of an understatement. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God that giveth to all men liberally. Now, this verse of scripture comes on the heels of that verse of scripture that says, count it all joy when you fall into divers temptations. The word divers means many temptations. Count it all joy when bad things happen in your life, knowing that the trying of your faith worketh patience. And let patience have her perfect work. But if you don't understand why you're going through what you're going through, let him ask of God. And he will help you to understand. But this is the way you ask. That giveth to all men liberally, and upbraideth not, and it shall be given unto him. You got the promise. If you'll ask God in the right attitude, not like Jonah did, but like Jeremiah did. Not like Peter did, but like Jeremiah did. But let him ask in faith. You know, it takes faith to have a right attitude. Did you know that? Anybody can come up with a bad attitude. That's pretty easy to do. Comes normal for me. Anybody can say the wrong thing. I do it all the time. My mouth is a whole lot better shut than it is open. Most of the time. Unless God gives me a word. But he that asks in faith, nothing wavering. For he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. One day you want to live for God, the next day you don't. That's not the way to live for God. Steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord is what Paul said. There was a sister in our church that was going through some difficult times in her life. She happens to be downstairs teaching. Most of you know who I'm talking about. She's gone through quite a plethora of one thing after another. And the Lord gave her a scripture. It's in the book of 1 Peter, the 5th chapter. Amen. I think about this quite often. 1 Peter, the 5th chapter, the 10th verse. But the God of all grace. No, let's back up. 8th verse. Be sober. Be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. Whom resist steadfast. Oh, look at there. Steadfast. What a coincidence. Whom resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. Oh, I love this 10th verse. But the God of all grace, who hath called us into his eternal glory by Jesus Christ, after that ye have suffered a while, make you, notice these four things, make you perfect, establish, establish, strengthen, settle you. It's really hard to pastor people that aren't settled. You need to get settled down. If you can't get your mind out of the world, maybe you ought to go on back out there until you get enough of it. Yeah. This church is not a prison, ladies and gentlemen. It'd be better for you to just get on out there and check it out. Check out what new street drug there is out there, if that's what you want to do. Check out some kind of an alternate lifestyle that the Hollywood says is really good, if that's what you want to do. Go get you a sex change operation, if that's what you want to do. Oh, this makes people nervous when I talk like this. Because really, you need to get your mind made up that there's nothing out there worth having. If you was a multi-billionaire, you know what? You still wouldn't be happy because you'd just want a little more. The flesh cannot be satisfied. It has to be crucified. Your ego cannot be satisfied. It has to be nailed to the cross. And you have got to learn how to die. You've got to be dead to the world. You've got to be dead to the things of the flesh. You don't have a problem with dead people. The safest place in Topeka, Kansas is the graveyard. Them dead people ain't going to bother you. It's those people that are alive that you better look out for. And folks, it's our job to be dead to the things of the world and alive to the things of God. Obviously, we need to continually remind ourselves that we do not have all the facts. Our vision is somewhat short-sighted, so we should never think that we know more than God knows. We should be willing to always trade our ways for God's ways. Could we stand to our feet, everybody? Let's thank the Lord for His ways, His plans, and His will for our lives right now. Lord, in Jesus' name. Oh, we want Your will and Your plan and Your ways and Your thinking and everything that You have for us this day, Lord. Bind that old spirit of anger and confusion and let order and happiness and joy and victory and mercy and peace come upon us here today. Oh, thank You, Jesus. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You, Jesus. Amen. Isn't He wonderful, wonderful, wonderful? Isn't Jesus?